الله والحمد لله، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على خير خلق الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، أستاذ brother Adnan just mentioned this is going to be an open Q&A session. We only have until Maghrib really, so really we are very limited in time. And so what I really want to impress upon everyone is that the questions be related to the subject matter. So the question, and inshallah, if Brother Ajmal, as the brothers come up, can make sure that the questions that they have, as well as your written questions, pertain to the topic. So we have literally about half an hour. And so we want to make sure that the questions are pertaining to the topic. There's been a lot of information and material that's been given out today. And we want to ensure that we give preference to this issue first and foremost. And so there's a lot of written questions we received that are very general. And so we're going to put those to the side. And inshallah, we're going to deal with the subject matter today. So if you have your questions, inshallah, please keep them to the topic. Jazakumullah khair. Tafadhal.
Assalamu alaikum. من قبل الشيخ فيصل ذكر أن في صيفين من الخوارج. في الخوارج الذين مات كلام عنهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وفي الذين يخرجون الحاكم مثلا لو الحاكم كان ظالم عليهم. وأيضا ذكر أن من خرج على الحاكم ومات فهو مات موت الجاهلية، فهل هذا يتطبق على السيفين من الذين يخرجون على الحاكم، أو هل يتطبق إلى على الخوارج بمعنى الذين مات ابتدعوا في عقيدتهم عقيدة الخوارج؟
لم نفهم.
Okay. The Sheikh Faisal Aliya said that there is two type of khuruj. There is the khuruj of the Khawarij who have the belief of the Khawarij, and there is the khuruj of the people who made this jihad, like the people who have some knowledge and they live in a country where they are oppressed by the governor or by the hakim. And they make khuruj on him. So he said that both of them are wrong, but he said that the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ concerning the khawarij are only concerning the first type of khawarij. But also he said that whoever make khuruj on the hakim and die in this state, he has died the death of a jahiliya.
Okay. I think I have your question.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بالنسبة للخوارج، اسم الخوارج اسم ذم، والشيخ فيصل حفظه الله أبو عثمان موجود وسيجيب عن هذا التساؤل إن شاء الله، بحكم أنه السؤال موجه ومتعلق بدرسه. أنا
The question was posed to Sheikh Faisal, and alhamdulillah Sheikh Faisal is here so he can answer the question.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. الصنف الأول الذين يخرجون عن اعتقاد فاسد، هؤلاء هم الذين جاءت الأحاديث الكثيرة في ذمهم ووصفهم بأنهم كلاب أهل النار، شر قتلة تحت أديم السماء، والعلماء يسمونهم بالخوارج المارقة. طيب، والقسم الثاني هؤلاء الذين خرجوا، قلنا أنهم على قسمين، إما أن يخرجوا طلبا للملك وصراعا على الدنيا، فهؤلاء يسمون بالخوارج على اعتبار الخروج وليسوا بالخوارج الذين هم المارقة، ويسمى فعلهم خروجا كما ذكرنا نصوص الإمام أحمد رحمه الله. وهؤلاء قد جاء فيهم عن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قوله الحمد لله الشيطان الرجيم. قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: من خلع عدا من طاعة فمات فميتته ميتة جاهلية. وجاء عن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قال: ينصب لكل غادر لواء يوم القيامة عند استه. وأعظم الغدر كما قال ابن عمر غدر إمام عامة، أي أن ينقض الإنسان بيعة الإمام ويخرج عليه. فهؤلاء جاء فيه مثل هذا الحديث الذي فيه التحذير ممن نزع يده من طاعة إمامه وميتته ميتة جاهلية، لأن أهل الجاهلية لم يكن لهم إمام يقتدون به بل كانوا متفرقين. وأما الإسلام فقد جاء بجمع المسلمين على خلف إمامهم والسمع والطاعة والصبر عليه. فمن مات ميتة جاهلية هذه تنطبق على هؤلاء وأولئك من باب أولى. وأما الحديث أنهم كلاب أهل النار شر خلقها فلا تنطبق على النوع الثاني. وذكرنا أن منهم من هم خرجوا يعني لدفع مظلمة ظلموا بها أو غضبا لله عز وجل، وهم أخطأوا بذلك، وقد يكون بعضهم مجتهدا مخطئا.
الشيخ أبو عثمان فيصل الجاسم حفظه الله، he said in response to the question of the brother that we said that there are two types of khawarij. The first are those people who have the aqidah of the khawarij, and these are the original khawarij, and they are the ones that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described them in the sunnah as being the dogs of the fire and as being of the worst of creation. As for the second type of khawarij, then there are those people who make khuruj, meaning that they rebel against their leaders. They don't necessarily have the aqidah, but because of maybe the oppression that they see and justice and so on, they have the action of the khawarij, and that is that they cause rebellion. And this is something which he discussed and mentioned before as being a statement of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. Concerning the second group of people who rebel against the leaders, then there are ahadith concerning these people as well. From them is a statement of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam: whosoever removes the hand of obedience, meaning that they rebel against the ruler, and then they die upon this, they will die a death of ignorance, of jahiliyyah. And in the other hand, narration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam: for every treacherous person on yawm al-qiyamah, there will be a flag which will be placed on their rear side. And as Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu mentioned, that the greatest type of treachery is the one that a person does towards the ruler of the Muslims, meaning that they rebel. And so the Shaykh mentioned that there are both of these types of hadith that we have as well. So the person who dies a death of ignorance, even though it is about this type of person, the first group who have the aqidah of the khawarij, it is even more applicable to them because they actually hold that belief, and that is a part of their creed and their theology. As for the other way around, then the ahadith that speak about the first group being the dogs of the fire, the worst of creation, those ahadith are not applied on the second group, those people who just rebel against a ruler, because perhaps some of them have made genuine mistakes. Although they are mistaken, perhaps some of them didn't know any better, they were ignorant, and so on and so forth. And so you have both of these types of people.
وصنف الثاني الذين هم لم يخرجوا عن اعتقاد فاسد، العلماء لم يصطلحوا على تسميتهم بالخارج، يعني ما سموا من خرج على حاكم الحكام أنهم من الخوارج، لكن قد يطلقون على فعلهم خروجا وأن فلان قد خرج. أما إذا أطلق الخوارج فإن الخوارج كلمة ذم، وغاء العلماء إذا أطلقوها أرادوا بها الخوارج الذين هم قد عرفوا باعتقادهم الفاسد بتكفير المسلمين واستحلال دمائهم. أما الصنف الثاني فيسمون عند العلماء بالبغاة كما ذكرنا ذلك، وهذا له باب في أبواب الفقه وهو ما يتعلق بقتال البغاة.
The Shaykh then concluded and he said, the second type of group, these people who rebel against the rulers, they see some oppression or whatever and they rebel. These people amongst the scholars of Islam are not known as the Khawarij. Even though they have the action of rebellion and that same type of action, they are not called the Khawarij. Rather, in the books of creed and theology, the books of Aqidah, when the word Khawarij is mentioned, it is an unpraiseworthy term. It is a term which diminishes a person, belittles a person. And so therefore that is applied only to those people who have that belief and that creed. As for the second type of people who rebel against the rulers, then they are known as transgressors. This is the terminology that encompasses them, and Allah knows best.
وأنا أحب أن أعتذر حقيقة للشيخ أحسن حنيف، لأن الشيخ دكتور شريعة ولست أنا بدكتور، والمفترض أنا أترجم له، وهذه حقيقة أقولها لا أقولها من باب التواضع، لكن جزاه الله خير هذا من تواضعه نفع الله.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Just a quick question. I've got two questions actually, if that's okay.
One at a time.
The first question is, in this day and age, we have this concept of Tawhid al-Hakimiyya, that's many of the takfiris that talk about. And a lot of people, we have some statements by the major scholars that are quite explicit in saying that this concept is an innovation and it contains a lot of falsehood. And we have some scholars like Al-Albani who are not so explicit in their condemnation of it. So some people, what they do now is say it's a matter of a difference of opinion, so it's acceptable. So what can the people, scholars say about that? And a second.
Yes, لقد توحيد الحاكمية من العلماء من صرح بأن هذه بدعة وليس من داخل من أقسام التوحيد. ومنهم من مبهم كلامه مبهم مثل الشيخ الألباني لم يصرح بهذا ولا ذاك فيوجد من الناس من يقول أن هذا خلاف بين العلماء.
التوحيد عند العلماء يقولون هو توحيد في المعرفة والإثبات أي الربوبية والأسماء والصفات، وتوحيد في الطلب والقصد وهو توحيد الألوهية. وربما فصلوا فقالوا هو توحيد الألوهية وتوحيد الربوبية وتوحيد الأسماء والصفات. ولم ينقل عن أحد من أهل العلم المعروفين بالعلم والرسوخ فيه أنهم أفردوا توحيداً رابعاً سموه الحاكمية. ومن زعم أن هناك قسم رابع وهو الحاكمية فإنه خرج عن طريقة أهل العلم، فإن قال إن هذا سببه الوضع المعاصر وأن الأوضاع المعاصرة والحكومات المعاصرة حصل فيها تقصير أو إضاعة، فهذا كلام غير مقبول، لأنه قيل هذا في علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه واحتج عليه وعلى تصرفاته بهذه الحجة، حجة الحاكمية، وقالوا له حكمت الرجال، حكمت بغير ما أنزل الله. وأيضاً الذين يدعون إلى هذا النوع ويبالغون فيه تجدهم يهملون توحيد الألوهية أو يضعفون فيه، وهذا خلاف طريقة أهل العلم، بل هو خلاف طريقة القرآن وطريقة الرسل عليهم الصلاة والسلام. والخلاصة أنه ليس هناك يعني قسماً رابعاً ولا قسماً خامساً. وسمعت من بعض الناس أنه يقول أن هناك أقسام كثيرة أكثر من هذا، كل هذا غير صحيح. هذه الأقسام العلمية التي حررها أهل العلم لا يجوز الخروج عن جادتهم ولا يجوز الخروج عن طريقتهم. ثم نبين ما معنى الحاكمية وما معنى هذه الكلمة، لا بد من بيان معناها. ثم إذا فهمنا المعنى فنقول إن الحكم بما أنزل الله فرض واجب على كل مسلم وعلى كل حاكم وعلى كل قاض يفصل بين الناس. والتحاكم والرضا بشرع الله لا يتم الإيمان إلا به، فلا وربك لا يؤمنون حتى يحكموك فيما شجر بينهم ثم لا يجدوا في أنفسهم حرجا مما قضيت ويسلموا تسليما. وهذا من توابع توحيد الألوهية، أن يتحاكم إلى شرع الله. فإفراد هذا النوع حقيقة يتضمن خروج عن جادة أهل العلم، ويتضمن الدعوة إلى الغلو السابق الذي كان عليه الخوارج. ولا نقول في كل من أفرده أنه من الخوارج، لكن نقول إنه غلط. وش يقول الشيخ الألباني؟ إيش ما فهمتنا الألباني؟
يقول أن كلامه مفهوم هو الحاضر.
الشيخ الألباني رحمه الله عالم فاضل محدث إمام، نترحم عليه ونعرف سابقته، وهو من كبار دعاة إلى مذهب السلف الصالح رحمه الله، وله جهود كثيرة في الرد على الغلاة والرد على المنحرفين في مسائل التكفير من الخوارج، وأسأل الله جل وعلا أن يغفر له ويرحمه. لكن لم أقف على كلامه في هذا الموضوع، وربما يعني الأخ السائل يعني يأتي بكلام الشيخ وننظر فيه.
The Sheikh said in response that the categories of Tawheed are three, as is mentioned by the scholars of Islam: Tawheed al-Rububiyya, the oneness of Allah and His Lordship; Tawheed al-Asma' al-Sifat, the oneness of Allah in His names and His attributes; and Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jal in His worship. And it's not mentioned from the scholars of Islam that they, or the well-known scholars of Islam, that they had a fourth type of Tawheed and a fourth category of Tawheed known as Hakimiyya. And so whosoever says this, this is people from our modern times that come up with this, and this is something which is not known amongst the scholars of Islam. But rather the people that say this, meaning that we should have this fourth type of category, or that there is this fourth type of category, because people in our times especially don't go back to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ when it comes to judging in their affairs, then these are those same types of people who said this same type of statement to Ali radiallahu anhu during his time, as we've mentioned before. And they would say about Ali that he has placed men to rule in these affairs, and that he is ruling other than that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed. And so this type of thing, to have more than these three types of Tawheed, you'll find that these people who have these extra categories of Tawheed, then most likely they won't pay much attention to calling to the oneness of Allah, calling people to worship Allah Azza wa Jal alone, calling people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not associate anyone with him in worship. And this is against and in opposition to the way of the Quran and the way of the prophets and the messengers of Allah and the way of the scholars of Islam. For in Tawheed there are only these three categories. There is not a fourth type nor a fifth type. And the Sheikh said that he has even heard people say that there are many, many categories of Tawheed. No one knows their reality. There are so many of them that we can add to this. And all of this, he said, is something which is incorrect. But rather we must affirm and stick to that which the scholars have mentioned, and that be types and categories of Tawheed. He then went on to say this word Al-Hakimiyya, we need to understand what it means. What is it and what does it entail and what is it referring to? He said, no doubt that judging by that which Allah revealed is a part of our religion, and it is an obligation upon the Muslim rulers and upon the judges and so on, that they go back to the Quran and the Sunnah, and that is what they rule by. As Allah Azza wa Jal said, and know by your Lord they will never truly believe until they make you the judge in their affairs. And that verse is very well known from the Quran. But rather al-Hakimiyya, and judging by that which Allah has revealed, it is a part of Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, uniting Allah, unifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His worship. It is a part of the category of Tawheed. As for making it a separate category, then this is something which is incorrect. And this is one of the characteristics of the Khawarij. The Sheikh said that we don't call those people Khawarij, but it is from their characteristics that they have this fourth type of Tawheed. And the Sheikh said, as for what the brother mentioned concerning Sheikh Al-Albani, then we know the Sheikh to be a great scholar of Islam, a man of virtue, someone who has many, many years of servicing this religion of Islam and calling to the correct Aqeedah. But the Sheikh said that he's not aware of his speech and his statements in this regard and in this issue.
Assalamu alaikum. If I can remember, the speakers mentioned that the jihad can be only declared by the leaders. And I want to know who are these leaders, because at the moment, is it the leaders of an Islamic state, or because we don't have a caliph as such, and we don't have a unified Islamic leader. So who can basically declare jihad at the moment? Thank you.
طيب الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على الحاكم الذي ذكرنا بأن إعلان الجهاد منوط به هو كل من حكم بلدا من البلاد وله ولاية وسلطان هو الذي يعلن الجهاد، وليس إعلان الجهاد لأحد الناس، ولا يشترط في من يعلن الجهاد من الحكام أن يكون خليفة عاما، فإن الخليفة العام الذي يحكم جميع المسلمين قد انقرض هذا الأمر من سنين طويلة، وقد أجمع المسلمون على أن كل من تغلب على بلد من البلاد واستتب له الأمر فإنه إمام له جميع ما جاءت الشريعة من أحكام الإمام من السمع والطاعة. نعم.
Sheikh Hafizahullah, he replied and he said that the Muslim ruler that we are referring to are those people who rule the Muslim lands. They are people who have power, they are people of authority. These are the rulers. And this affair of jihad goes back to them, and they are the ones who make that decision and that declaration. And it's not for the individual people to go into this and start giving religious rulings concerning this. The Sheikh said that it's also not a condition that that person is necessarily the Khalifa, because for many, many hundreds of years now, the Muslim Ummah has not known one single Khalifa that unites all of the Muslim Ummah together. Rather, this is something which has finished some time ago. But rather, the ruler is the one who, over a group of lands or over a country, he has rulership, he has authority, he has power. That is the ruler that we are referring to.
Sahim. I wanted to ask a question twofold. The first is that a lot of people with Khawariji ideas will
Sorry?
Say...
Sorry, can you repeat
that? A lot of people with Khawariji ideas will often say that this is a Darul Harb, and they'll often refer to this the area we live in as being in the West, and therefore it's an abode of war. So are we... What constitutes an abode of war? And secondly, if we don't have a Khilafah now to establish leadership, or an emir al-mu'mineen, do we need to push for one, as a lot of people are saying?
Okay. سألوا عن دار حرب هذه. بالنسبة للسؤال الأول، ديار هنا وفي الأغلب لا تسمى ديار حرب، لأن بينها وبين المسلمين عهود ومواثيق وصلح، وهذا يجعلها يعني ليست ديار حرب يعني تقوم فيها الحرب. هذا السؤال الأول. هي ديار كفر لا شك، لكن لا يقال عنها ديار حرب. والسؤال الثاني، هل نسعى في الخلافة؟ ولا تسعى، عليك أن تسعى للصلاة مع الجماعة وحضور الجمعة وتعلم العلم الشرعي، وأن تجمع كلمة المسلمين على الخير وعلى السنة وعلى التوحيد، هذا يكفيك. وأما أمور الملك والخلافة فالغالب أن السعي فيها يسبب يعني الفتن بين المسلمين وسفك الدماء. وأنا أحب لك ما أحب لنفسي، إذا كنت في بلد مسلم عنده حاكم مسلم فاسمع وأطع، وإياك أن تخوض في الفتن والدماء. وإذا كنت في بلد غير مسلم فعليك بالصبر والسعي أن تذهب إلى ديار المسلمين إذا استطعت إلى ذلك سبيلا حتى تكون مع المسلمين، وإن لم تستطع كنت عاجزا فعليك بأن تحافظ على نفسك وإسلامك وعلى أهلك وأهل بيتك، وأن تحفظ إسلامك بالقيام بالفرائض والبعد عن المحارم، فهذا خير لك.
The Sheikh in response, Hafizahullah, he said that the lands of war, what is known as Darul Harb, then this isn't something which we would refer to this country as being and the Western countries generally, because the Muslims have come here and they have protection and they have signed contracts and there is peace treaties between these countries and the Muslim countries. And so even though they are non-Muslim countries, no doubt they are countries of disbelief and the countries of the non-Muslims, but they are not lands of war, rather they are lands which have peace treaties between them and the Muslims. And so that was the first part of the question. The second part of the question, the Sheikh responded and he said, concerning the Khilafah, then this isn't something which he would advise you to go and promote, nor is it something that he would advise you to go and seek. Rather, he advises you to pray in congregation in the masjid and to come for the Jum'ah prayer and to seek knowledge and to spread that beneficial knowledge. And he said, because people who often go around searching and trying to delve into these affairs of power and authority and leadership, then that leads to a lot of fitan, leads to a lot of trials, and it leads to bloodshedding and many other evil things. And the Sheikh said that I love for you what I love for myself. If you live in a Muslim country, then obey the ruler there, listen to the ruler there, and and be upon that. Be content with that and don't go into those affairs which will lead into trials and which will lead into bloodshedding. And if you're in a non-Muslim country, then he would advise you, if you're able to go to a Muslim country, then to do so. And if you're unable to, then preserve yourself, your family, your religion, learn about your religion and make sure that you are strong upon that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Alhamdulillah, نضيف بطلب الشيخ فهد تعليق على قضية طلب الخلافة. لابد أن نعلم أيها الأحبة بأن الخلافة ليس من الأمر الذي يسعى إليه أحد الناس لإقامته، فإن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قد عرضت عليه الإمارة والإمامة، قال له إن شئت أمارة أمرناك علينا بحيث لا نقطع أمرا دونك، تصبح أميرا. مع ذلك ما قبل النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام، لأن همه كانت دعوة. وقد ذكر الله تبارك وتعالى قصص الأنبياء في القرآن، لم يذكر عن أحد منهم أنه طلب الخلافة أو طلب الإمارة على الناس، وإنما جاء لدعوة الناس وتصحيح عقائدهم. ولذلك الخلافة التي يراد كما يدندن عليها حزب التحرير وغيره من الأحزاب، الخلافة تأتي تبعاً بعد أن يصلح الناس وأحوالهم. فإذا أصلح الناس ما بينهم تبارك وتعالى، ما بينهم بين أمرائهم، أقام الله عز وجل جمع كلمة المسلمين، فكلمة المسلمين تجتمع إذا صحت عقائدهم. هذه سنة الله الشرعية والكونية.
The Sheikh Faisal Jassim حفظه الله, he had an addition to make, and that is concerning this issue of the Khilafah. He said that this isn't something which individuals and small groups of people go out and try to pursue. This is something which isn't done on an individual level. And he mentioned that even the Prophet ﷺ was given the option and given that offer of becoming a leader amongst the Quraysh when he was still in Mecca. And the Quraysh said to him that we will make you our leader to the extent that we won't take a single decision, do a single thing except with your approval. So they offered him this type of leadership. But the Prophet ﷺ didn't agree. He didn't accept this. Why? Because his main purpose was that he should go and make da'wah, that he should call people to the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Shaykh said that when you go through the Quran and the many stories of the prophets of Allah within the Quran, you don't find that they go out asking for leadership in any single story of those stories of the prophets. But rather they were calling to the way of Allah, they were calling to the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so that is what is important for us. This issue of khilafah is something which will come as a result of the rectification of the people. When people have good aqidah, when they come and they unite upon this type of correct methodology and correct and sound creed and theology, then after that Allah Azza wa Jalla will allow for them to have that rulership, allow for them to have the khilafah. And this is something which Allah Azza wa Jalla has established. It is one of His sunnah, one of His established practices in the universe. That it is first the aqidah that we must work upon, and then other things which come as a result of that.
Okay, my question, coming from an outside perspective, outside Birmingham, is that we don't really have this problem in Scotland, alhamdulillah, with Allah's blessing. We don't really have this problem of takfir and takfiris and a lot of sort of like different groups opposing each other, and we're quite blessed that way up to now. But I've seen and some research with some of the brothers in Scotland, we've realized that this epidemic of the Shabab of this country, specifically within the UK, getting involved with takfiri or khawarij mentality, which this entire session is about, seems to be most apparent in socially, economically deprived areas, such as like in Brixton, London, Manchester and Birmingham and other cities. Do you think that this lack of Islamic knowledge and academic ability and living in a semi-enclosed community where unemployment, education and crime is very high, do you think this is also a cause for this epidemic of this sense of hatred within these deprived areas and within these pockets of community? That's basically the context of the main question, which you can inshallah translate to the Shaykh. The real question is that because of this research and things that are coming out regarding this, do the Shaykh here think that the masajid, like Green Lane is one of them, should be in a position now where they should be concentrating and establishing at grassroots level this lost science of adab and akhlaq? Because we're living in a time where knowledge is so 10 years ago, back in the 90s, knowledge was not as apparent like the way it is now because of Facebook, Google, etc., etc. 18-year-olds nowadays are coming up with dalil and evidence and giving you their shuyukh and stuff. But, so there's knowledge around, a lot of people have it, but there's no one teaching adab and how to handle this sacred knowledge, this prophetic guidance. So do you think that the masajid now, like Green Lane and other masajid throughout the country, especially in these areas like Brixton, Birmingham, Manchester, should be concentrating on adab as a topic, bithnallah, in the future? Jazakallah khair.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهداه. ربما من أحد أسباب تبني بعض الشباب لفكر الخوارج هو أن هذا الفكر يناسب أهواءهم ويناسب أخلاقهم ويناسب واقعهم، ولذلك أثر عن كثير من الخوارج الذين كانوا يتصفون بالشدة والغلظة أنهم تبنوا مذهب الخروج لا لأنه حق، لكنهم لشدتهم وغلظتهم وجدوا أن أنسب الأشياء التي تناسب أخلاقهم وأهواءهم وطبائعهم هو مذهب الخوارج. وهذا من الهوى الذي قد يخفى على الإنسان، فبعض الناس يتبع الطريقة التي تناسب هواه ولا يكون مقصوده اتباع الحق، هذا أمر. وذلك ما ذكر السائل من قضايا الأخلاقية والمشاكل الاقتصادية وذلك، نعم هذه أسباب تبني هؤلاء بعض الناس، بعض الشباب إذا نقم على المجتمع أو رأى أنه فقير أو أنه في ضيق الحياة وجد الطريق الذي يريد أن يشفي غليله بتبني فكر التكفير والطعن في الناس والخوض فيهم وما شابه ذلك، لأنه يكون من باب ردة الفعل. هذا من بعض الأسباب التي تؤول وتؤدي إلى الخروج. أما قضية الاهتمام بالأخلاق والآداب فلا شك أن هذا من الدين. النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قال إنما بعثت لأتمم مكارم الأخلاق، ومن أعظم الأخلاق الخلق مع الله، وهو أن يكون الإنسان على عقيدة سليمة في حق الله تبارك وتعالى متبعا للكتاب والسنة. وذلك أهل السنة والجماعة طريقتهم هي طريقة التزكية والتصفية وطريقة الأخلاق. النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام إنما بعث لأجل ذلك، قال الله تبارك وتعالى هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى، قال تبارك وتعالى هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياتي ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة. فذكر الله جل وعلا أن من حكم بعثة النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام تزكية النفوس. ولذلك إذا أخذ الإنسان منهج أهل السنة على وجهه الكامل الصحيح فإنه ولا بد ستزكو أخلاقه. وذلك الدعوة إلى تزكية الأخلاق وتصفيتها من أمور مهمة. وبعض الناس قد يطلب العلم ولا يتعلم الأدب، وذلك كان الإمام أحمد رحمه الله يقول نحن إلى قليل من الأدب أحوج منا إلى كثير من العلم. واليوم قد يكون هذا الشيء مفقودا، تجد بعض الناس يتعلمون العلم لكنهم لم يتعلموا الأدب. وذلك عني العلماء بتعليم الأدب، أداب الطلب، أداب العلم، أدب مع الناس وما شابه ذلك. يقول الذهبي رحمه الله كان يحضر حلقة الإمام أحمد 5500 يكتبون أي الحديث، وأربعة آلاف وخمسمائة يتأدبون. وكان بعضهم يقول إذا رأيت الإمام أحمد استقمت 40 يوما. وكان كثير منهم يحضرون إلى حلقة العالم ليتعلموا، لينظر إلى سمته وهديه ودله وأدبه. فالأدب مطلوب، وأكثر الناس أدبا المفترض أن يكونوا أصحاب هذه الدعوة السلفية، دعوة أهل السنة والجماعة. لكن لأخذ بعض الناس جوانب منها وجهلهم وتركهم لجوانب أخرى وقعوا فيما ذكره السائل. لذلك هذا جزء مما يعتنى به، لكن أعظم ما يجب الاعتناء به هو تصحيح العقيدة. فإن صحت العقيدة سهل على الناس أن تصح أخلاقهم وأدابهم. الله أعلم.
الشيخ حفظه الله تعالى، he responded to the question of the brother and he said that no doubt from the many reasons and from the many reasons for which we have this issue of takfir and this issue of the khawarij is because it is to some people more applicable to them than others. For some people it meshes and emerges with their natural disposition, with their nature, with their character and with the way that they are. And that's why the Sheikh said that you find that there are certain people who this is their character, that they're known to be rough and tough and harsh towards others. And so this is also a type of following your desires when you choose that way that is more applicable to your nature. And so some people, when they had these types of issues, they came to Islam and they tried to choose a way. They found that the easiest way for them to adopt and the easiest nature or the easiest way that their nature would be compatible with was this way of the khawarij because of the roughness and the toughness and the harshness that is contained within it. And the Sheikh said that this is a type of following one's desires and this is something which we don't often pay attention to. He said no doubt also that from the reasons why these issues are around is because of the social issues that we have and the economical issues maybe that we have and also the moral issues that we have, that we don't have the adab as we should have, as we should have, and that characteristics and the character that a Muslim should be upon. Know that this is something which is important in the religion. It is a major aspect and foundation of this religion that we have good character. As our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, indeed I have only been sent to perfect the Islamic character, to perfect the character of the Muslim. And the greatest character that a person needs to have is the character and etiquette that they have with their Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With the way that they have their aqidah, their methodology, their creed, their theology is correct, it is in alignment with the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then from that, they purify their souls. They have this tazkiyatun nafs, where they purify their souls in accordance to the Quran and the Sunnah. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said concerning our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he is the one, meaning Allah is the one who sent the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to an illiterate people so that he may recite to them from the book and so that he may purify them and teach them the book and the wisdom. And so Allah Azza wa Jal said that from the major roles of the Prophet ﷺ was that he would purify people, meaning that he would teach them character and good etiquette and that he would teach them good mannerisms. And so this is something which is very important in our religion. And that's why you find that there are certain people who don't have that characteristic, they don't have that character, and so they do things which are not necessary and which a person shouldn't do. The Sheikh mentioned many of the statements of the scholars of the past, how much importance that they would place upon the issue of good character and good etiquette. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah said that we are more in need of a little bit of etiquette than we are of much knowledge. And unfortunately, this is something which we see today, that character is something nearly lost amongst the Muslims. That people, even though they may have knowledge, they may seek knowledge, they don't have the character and the attributes and the etiquettes that should accompany that knowledge. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala said that Imam Ahmad rahimahullah in his lectures he would have 5,000 people. Only 500 of them would write, meaning they were the serious students of knowledge. They were there to write and seek knowledge. The other 4,500 would attend just to learn from his character, just to watch the way that he was, just to benefit from his mannerisms and his etiquettes. And that's why it is reported that other people said that I would go to Imam Ahmad rahimahullah just to see him. And then after that, for 40 days, I would remain upright. 40 days, just by seeing the way that he was, rahimahullahu ta'ala. So no doubt, this is something which the scholars of the past placed great importance upon, that a person should have good character, they should have good etiquettes and mannerisms towards others. And the Sheikh said that it is unfortunate that sometimes we take certain aspects of knowledge and we leave others, that we learn certain things about Salafiyya and take them and we ignore others. And from those things that we ignore is good character. But he said it's also important to know that the main and most important fundamental issue that we need to focus upon is our aqidah, correcting and rectifying our belief and creed. Because if that is correct, then all of these other issues will come as a result and they will be much easier to apply once we have the correct methodology, and Allah knows best.
There is one written question, which is, where, and it's for Sheikh Fahad, where in the world is there jihad today? Where in the world is there jihad today?
Yes, the question says, where is the jihad today? Where is the jihad?
The jihad, now, first thing, the jihad is a shari'i. قال تعالى في القرآن العظيم في سورة الفرقان وهي سورة مكية ولم ينزل بعد فرض الجهاد. قال تعالى: وجاهدهم به جهادا كبيرا. وقال تعالى في سورة الحج: وجاهدوا في الله حق جهاده واجتباكم وما جعل عليكم في الدين من حرج ملة أبيكم إبراهيم. معلوم أن إبراهيم عليه الصلاة والسلام لم ينزل أو لم يشرع في حقه الجهاد بمعنى القتال في وقته. وإذن الجهاد جهاد الدعوة إلى الله عز وجل، الدعوة إلى توحيده، الدعوة إلى القرآن والسنة، الدعوة إلى الإيمان بالرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم واتباع سنته، جهاد النفس، جهاد الشيطان، وجهاد الهوى، وجهاد المنافقين، وجهاد الكفار. فكل هؤلاء يجاهدون بالعلم والبيان والنصح وإقامة الحجة. هذا الآن متيسر لمن طلب العلم، ومتيسر لمن عنده مال يطبع به الكتب وينشر به الدين ويرد به على المبتدعين أو المجادلين والمشككين أو الملحدين، يساهم في نشر الحق عبر وسائل التواصل الاجتماعي أو في المقاطع اليوتيوب، ينشر الحق والدين، ينشر كلام العلماء الراسخين في العلم. سبحان الله، ربما مقطع للشيخ عبد العزيز بن باز رحمه الله بصوته يسمعه بعض الناس، تضعه في اليوتيوب فيسمعه من شاء الله عز وجل ويهتدي به إلى الحق ويترك البدعة أو يترك المعصية. ربما جواب للشيخ محمد بن عثيمين عن شبهة تنشره، ثم يترك بعض الناس بدعته ويتوب، فتكون أنت ممن جاهد وساهم في نصرة الإسلام وتربية الأولاد. أنتم الآن في مكان تحتاجون إلى تعاون فيما بينكم واجتهاد كبير في حفظ أنفسكم وأولادكم، لأن هذه البلاد يعني منفتحة وليس هناك قيود، فربما يقع الإنسان في الرذيلة أو يقع فيما حرم الله عز وجل، فيحتاج إلى حماية لنفسه وإلى جهاد عظيم في البعد عن أسباب الفتنة والثبات على الاستقامة. وأذكر نفسي وإخواني واجعل هذا خاتمة بحديث عظيم رواه الإمام مسلم في صحيحه عن أم المؤمنين عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت: كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا قام يصلي في الليل يستفتح بهذا الدعاء: اللهم رب جبرائيل وميكائيل وإسرافيل فاطر السماوات والأرض عالم الغيب والشهادة أنت تحكم بين عبادك فيما كانوا فيه يختلفون اهدني لما اختلف فيه من الحق بإذنك إنك تهدي من تشاء إلى صراط مستقيم. فإذا كان سيد المرسلين يدعو بهذا الدعاء فنحن أشد حاجة إلى هداية الله عز وجل، خصوصا عند كثرة الخلاف والافتراق. فنسأل الله أن يهدينا وسائر إخواننا المسلمين صراطه المستقيم، وأن يعافينا من مضلات الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن. وإذا قام الجهاد الحقيقي ووجد سببه ووجد الداعي إليه، فحينئذ يشرع الجهاد بمعنى القتال، وذلك إذا وجدت الراية الشرعية والإمام الذي يدعو إليه والقدرة عند المسلمين والحاجة لذلك واتفاق وتوارد أهل العلم الراسخين في العلم. أسأل الله جل وعلا أن ينصر الإسلام وأهله وأن يعز المسلمين بطاعته واتباع سنة نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم. وجزاكم الله خير الجزاء، وأشكر الإخوة أولاً الشيخ فيصل جزاه الخير والإخوة القائمين على هذا الجامع والمركز المبارك، أشكرهم على إقامة هذه الجلسات المفيدة، وأسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يبارك في مساعيهم وينفع بجهودهم ويجعلها خالصة لوجه الكريم. ثم الشكر لكم أيها الإخوة الكرام أنتم على حضوركم وصبركم ومصابرتكم واستماعكم. أسأل الله أن ينفعنا وإياكم بما نقول ونسمع، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
Okay, so this is going to be the final question because we're running out of time, and the Sheikh also gave his conclusion as well at the end of answering this question. He said in response to the question that jihad is an Islamic terminology. It is a term of the Sharia. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Furqan in the Quran. And Surah Al-Furqan is a Makki surah, surah which is revealed in the Meccan period before even jihad was obligated upon the Muslims. And Allah Azza wa Jal says, and strive against them a great striving, make jihad against them in a great way. Likewise in Surah Al-Hajj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and strive for the sake of Allah in the right way. For indeed he is the one who chose you, and he did not make anything difficult upon you. This is the religion of your forefather Ibrahim. And the Sheikh said it's well known that the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam didn't have to make jihad. There was no such jihad for him during his time. And so the Sheikh said, therefore jihad has many meanings. And the jihad that we need to concern ourselves with in our times is the jihad of Tawheed, unifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his worship, the jihad of following the Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the jihad of following, having iman and belief in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and following his way, the jihad of stopping ourselves and refraining from following our desires and from following shaitan and from following everything which is evil, the jihad of spreading knowledge and calling people to Islam either by writing or through speech or through our teachings. He said, this is the type of jihad that we need, that we spread this type of knowledge in any which way that we can, whether it's by writing or by speaking or by using modern technology like YouTube and so on and so forth. The Sheikh said, imagine how much benefit there would be if a person came and he placed a small video clip of Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah speaking on a certain issue and he places it on YouTube. How many hundreds and thousands of people will benefit from this? How many people will be guided to the sunnah, and how many people will leave off bid'ah simply because of this? You bring another video clip of Sheikh bin Uthaymeen where he's responding to a doubt and he clarifies a doubt that is prevalent amongst the people. And so by his response, people leave that type of sin and that type of innovation. How much reward will you gain when you are the person that has placed that video clip on, when you're the person that was the reason for spreading that knowledge? This is what we need. The Sheikh said, we also need to preserve our children, to teach them, to give them good tarbiyah, because we live in a land where there is also much evil, things which aren't in accordance to our religion. And so we need to preserve our children and we need to make sure that they remain good Muslims. The Sheikh also said, then I want to conclude by saying and reminding myself and you of the famous hadith of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the authority of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha in Sahih Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he would stand to pray the night prayer, then he would begin his prayer with this dua, and that is, O Allah, the Lord of Jibreel and the Lord of Mikael and the Lord of Israfil, the originator of the heavens and the earth, the one who knows the hidden and the unseen, you are the one who judges between your slaves in that in which they differ. So Allah, guide me to that in which they differ, for indeed you are the one who guides to the straight path. The Sheikh said, look at how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would make this dua, and he is who he is. He would make this dua at the beginning of his prayer sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So this is what we need. We need Allah Azza wa Jal to guide us, and this is the guidance that we need. And then the Sheikh made dua for everyone, and he also said that if such a time and such a situation arises where there is a Muslim ruler and he calls towards jihad and the scholars agree upon this, that is then a different issue. And the Sheikh said that he wants to, in conclusion, thank our Sheikh Faisal Al-Jassim for his invite and the brothers who run this masjid and the people who are responsible for putting this program together. And he wants to thank you as well for your patience and for listening attentively. And he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he blesses everyone and he grants us success in this life and the next. So now inshallah Sheikh Faisal will give his conclusion as well.
Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah. Rubbama akhtim bi بياني أن هذا المؤتمر وهذا البرنامج هو من الجهاد في سبيل الله، لأن الجهاد المقصود الأعظم من الجهاد إن أرادنا بالجهاد القتال هو الدعوة إلى الله تبارك وتعالى، وبهذا أشار النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام إلى علي بن أبي طالب لما أمره في غزوة خيبر، قال عليه الصلاة والسلام بعدما أمره على الجيش قال له: لأن يهدي الله بك رجلا واحدا خير لك من حمر النعم، أي ليكن همك الأعظم هو هداية الناس. ولذلك مثل هذا المؤتمر ومثل طلب العلم هذا من الجهاد، ولا يقوى عليه إلا من صبره الله تبارك وتعالى. ولذلك أعظم المجاهدين في سبيل الله هم العلماء، أعظم مجاهدين. وإلا فإن القتال بمعنى القتال قد فعله كثير من الناس، يفعلونه شجاعة، يفعلونه حمية، يفعلونه من باب القوة، يفعلون باب الأنفة والغيرة، لكن طلب العلم لا يفعله إلا خواص الناس. والأنبياء من آدم عليه السلام إلى نبينا، أو قل إلى موسى عليه السلام على خلاف من العلماء، لم يؤمر أحد منهم بقتال قط، وإنما كان جهادهم هو الدعوة، وهو الجهاد المشترك بين جميع المرسلين، الدعوة والعلم. وهذا الذي ينبغي أن نحرص عليه قبل الخوض في هذه الأمور التي ليست من شأننا وقد تكون من شأن الولاة والحكام وأولي الأمر. وأكرر شكري للشيخ فهد، دكتور فهد جزاه الله خير على يعني على حضوره، مع أن الشيخ رحمه الله كان مرتبطا ببرنامج مع الشيخ بوزان، لكن أبى جزاه الله خير إلا أن يستجيب على الوعد الذي قطعه على نفسه. فنشكر الله سبحانه وتعالى على تيسير وصوله إلى هذه البلاد، ونشكر سعيه، كما نشكر جميع الإخوة القائمين على هذا المؤتمر، ونشكر جميع الحضور على الصبر، ونسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى يوفقنا وإياكم لما يحب ويرضى، والله أعلم، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد.
The Sheikh حفظه الله تعالى, he gave his conclusion by saying that he wanted to emphasize the point that jihad, this type of conference and this type of seminar, is a type of jihad in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the greatest goal and the greatest purpose of jihad is to call people to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Ali radiallahu anhu in the battle of Khaybar, when he made him a leader of the army, he said to him that if Allah were to guide by you a single person, then it would be better for you than the red camels, meaning the most prestigious, valuable type of wealth that you can attain. And so this is the point, that we want to guide people. The point isn't just to fight or kill, but it is to guide people to the way of Allah. And that's why the Shaykh said that seeking knowledge and spreading knowledge is a form of jihad. But rather, a person cannot do this type of jihad, meaning seeking knowledge and spreading knowledge, unless Allah Azza wa Jal grants them patience. These people, the people who are the scholars who spread knowledge and seek knowledge, they are the greatest types of mujahideen. These are the real people of jihad. Because people will fight and they will kill, some out of courage, some because they have some patriotic traits, some because they want to defend this or that, whatever the reason is. However, the people who seek knowledge and spread that knowledge, then they are the people who truly do this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are the best of people. And that's why it said that all of the prophets from the time of Adam alayhi salam until the time of the Prophet Musa alayhi salam, meaning just before our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, not a single one of them was ordered with jihad to fight. But rather, what was their type of jihad? Their striving was that they call people to Allah, that they spread knowledge, that they teach the people. And so this is what we need to focus on. This is what we need to be eager about, to seek knowledge and to spread that knowledge. That is what is the main purpose, to guide people to the path of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then the Shaykh concluded by thanking our Shaykh Fahd Al-Fuhayd for coming all the way from Saudi Arabia. Even though he was busy and he had some appointments and so on, he, alhamdulillah, was able to come and participate with us. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he blesses him and that he grants him good reward. And then he also thanked the brothers that organized this conference, as well as you, for your patience and for your attendance. Jazakumullahu khairan.